Welcome to this class. In this class, and if required in the subsequent class, we will go through what all we have covered till now. In other words, it will be a roundup of what we have covered over the last so many classes. So, by and large, what we have done is to cover these topics. That is, we started with introduction to strategic management. In this introduction to strategic management, we have covered these aspects: concept of corporate strategy, the strategic management process, the 7S framework, the corporate policy and planning in India. I will just take you through a brief journey, a summarized journey of what we have done in this section. So, if you really look at it, what we have done is to explain you what is meant by strategic planning. I have gone through the process by defining what is strategy. Then I have gone through the process of defining the vectors of strategy. Then I have defined strategic planning for you. Then what we have done is to look at purpose and mission. In this purpose and mission, what I have done is taken the example of a company and explained the mission statement. So, if you go to the previous this thing on strategy, I have explained to you the 4 vectors, that is the product market scope, the growth vector, the competitive advantage and the synergy by taking a pharmaceutical company. Then I have explained what is meant by the strategic planning process through a formal definition, and then what does it include? That is the management processes in organizations through which the future impact of change is determined and current decisions to reach a desired future are made. So, 2 aspects. When we started explaining this whole thing, that is, what does the whole process of strategic planning include? It includes the entire process of major outside interest groups, then their stakes, expectations of dominant inside stockholders. So, information, past, present and projected performance, then the evaluation of the company's strengths and the weaknesses, then the formulation of organizational purpose, mission, objectives, policies and strategies. Then we explained what is meant by this purpose and mission by taking the example of the Saturn Corporation, which has its mission statement as market vehicles developed and manufactured in the United States that are world leaders in quality, cost and customer satisfaction through the integration of people, technology and business systems, and to transfer knowledge, technology and expertise throughout General Motors. Then we explained what is meant by a business mission, taking the example of the Hallmark Company. Then we went from mission statement to strategic vision. We listed down what are the questions that must be answered. Broadly, what are the changes occurring in markets? What are the new or different customer needs that need to be satisfied? Then what are the new or different buyer segments we should concentrate? And what about the new geographic or product markets which the company should be pursuing? And what should be the company's business makeup? How should it look like in the next 5 years? And what kind of company should we be trying to build in the next 5 years? So, we looked at the goals of an organization, what will they do, the official goals described in the memorandum of association or the charter or the annual report. Then the operative goals, what organization is attempting to do. Then the operational goals, that is used by the supervisory personnel or managers to influence the behavior of subordinates and measure their performance. So, whereas the official goals are abstract, idealistic, the operative goals are actual goals but not articulated. The operational goals are detailed goals and measurable. We gave the pyramid of policies which can serve as a guide to action, that is the pyramid of business policies. Then we looked at different types of strategies, can be growth strategies, then it can be dependency reduction strategies, or it can be vertical integration strategies, which can be backward integration or the forward integration. What is the risk involved? Or it can be the generic strategies, which are essentially three, that is the overall cost leadership, differentiation and focus given by Porter. Then it can, the other strategies could be mergers and joint ventures. Then the turnaround strategies can be two types of turnaround, one entrepreneurial brought about by a person and efficiency referring to the organization as a whole. Business unit strategy and corporate strategy. Then we looked at what are the tests of a winning strategy. We are looking essentially at three tests. One is the goodness of fit test, that is match to industry and competitive condition, opportunities and threat. Then tailored to company strengths and weaknesses, competencies and capabilities. Then the second test is the competitive advantage test, which leads to sustainable competitive advantage. The third test is boost performance test, which boosts profitability and competitive strength and long-term position. Then we looked at why strategic decision making is important. We summarized it through a punchline. That punchline reading, organization's success or failure in the long run depends upon strategic decision making, that is upon doing the right things rather than upon doing things right. So, we gave a matrix comparing operating and strategic decisions. So, what happens when the when both the operating and strategic decisions are clear, and when it is effective or ineffective, that is the strategic decisions are clear, unclear, operating decisions are effective or ineffective. So, we looked at the four quadrants and we found that the first quadrant where the strategic decisions are clear and where the operating decisions are effective will be the most desirable for the organization. So, we went through some important definitions starting from strategic management process, that is the full set of commitments, decisions and actions required for a firm to achieve strategic competitiveness and earn above average returns. Then the strategic competitiveness, that is achieved when a firm successfully formulates and implements a value creating strategy. Then we looked at some important definitions like this above average returns. When does it occur? When a firm develops a strategy that competitors are not simultaneously implementing, then provides benefits which current and potential competitors are unable to duplicate. We defined risk, an investor's uncertainty about economic gains or losses that will result from a particular investment. Then average returns, returns that are equal to those an investor expects to earn from other investments with a similar amount of risk. Then we defined what is meant by strategic flexibility, that is a set of capabilities used to respond to various demands and opportunities existing in a dynamic and uncertain competitive environment. So, involves coping with uncertainty and the accompanying risks. Then we looked at the strategic management process, we looked at the block diagram, then we looked at the step and ladder diagram, then we looked at what is meant by a learning organization. So, we listed the four main activities of the learning organization, that is solving problems systematically, experimenting with new approaches, then learning from their own past experiences and past history, as well as from the experiences of others, and transferring knowledge quickly and efficiently throughout the organization. Then we looked at the different modes of strategic management decision making, could be entrepreneurial, that is one by powerful individual, then adaptive, then this is muddling, referred to as muddling through, that is characterized by reactive solutions to existing problems. So, it is a reactive mode of decision making basically. Then the planning mode, where you go through a systematic process. Then the fourth one is the logical incrementalization, which has a certain aspect of planning, adaptive and entrepreneurial mode of decision making. In other words, it combines certain components of planning, adaptive, and to a lesser extent, the entrepreneurial mode of decision making. Then we looked at the Indian scenario and again started saying which is the best decision making process in the present day context. We said the Indian organizations should go in not always for the planning mode, should be willing to take some risks, that is the entrepreneurial mode. Planning mode is perhaps the best method, best approach you could do, but if it calls for entrepreneurial mode of decision making in the present day liberalized scenario, the Indian organizations should be willing to go in for that. And they should also take the logical incrementalization mode quite seriously. So, this is what we said. Then we looked at the corporate plan by a diagram, that is a conceptual model of corporate planning, where we said how do we go through the process of corporate planning. Then we went through the 7S matrix. In the 7S matrix, if you see, we went through the all the aspects of the 7S, that is the superordinate goals at the center, then strategy, structure, systems, style, staff and skills forming the other 6 S's. So, this is giving you the complex relationship between strategy, structure, systems, style, skills, staff and superordinate goals. So, we explained what is meant by each of these S's. We took the example of organizations for superordinate goals, the American organizations, the Indian organizations. So, then we went to structure, we went through different examples. One of the things which we noted was the relationship between strategy and structure rarely provides unique structural solutions, always there are execution problems. So, we also said the strategy and the structure forms the hardware, the other 5 S's form the software of the 7S matrix. So, not give too much importance to software at the expense of the hardware was the statement that was made. So, one should not give too much importance to software at the expense of the hardware. So, this is in essence a critical analysis of the 7S framework, again looking at more from the Indian angle. So, in each of these sections, we have looked at what are the types of issues which we may be facing in the 21st century. For example, the types of trading associations, their impact, what the world might have, that is the 3 dominant trading blocks. Then, how important the strategic decision making process is likely to be in this type of a changed scenario. So, this is what we have dealt with. Then we have come to board of directors. In board of directors, we have defined what is a BOD, the powers of the BOD in section 292. Then we have looked at section 293 also, those are the two important sections with respect to BODs in the Indian Companies Act, and what is the type of expectations from the BODs. So, we have looked at who is a whole time director, who is a part time director, and what are the different types of board of directors which were mentioned, and now what has happened now. So, all this, the some of the new things, committees which were formed, including the recent Narayan Murthy's committees on the BODs. So, all this we have looked at that with respect to the BODs. So, we have also looked at four important strategic management styles depending on the degree of involvement by the BOD and the top management. One could be entrepreneurship, where you have a degree of involvement by BOD as well as by top management, which is very high. Suppose by top management it is high, but by BOD it is low, it becomes entrepreneurship. Suppose it is high on both the sides, it becomes partnership. Suppose it is low on both the sides, it leads to chaos. Then suppose it is low by the top management and high by the BOD, it becomes stipendiary, that is the BOD is trying to overreach. We also looked at what should be doing, what one should be doing for enhancing the BOD's effectiveness. Essentially, the Beer's 5-step systems model. Then we looked at what are the four responsibilities of business. One is the economic responsibility which a business has to do, that is, it has to be in the business to make some profits, that is, an organization is existing to make profits. So, you can't say profits the organization should not make at all. So, that is not the purpose with which the organization is created. Then legal, have to do, ethical, should do, discretionary, might do. And we looked at the ethical responsibility, and then we looked at social audit, took the an Indian example which was done, that is the Indian Petrochemicals at Vadodara at that point of time, now taken over by Reliance. So, the corporate governance reports of Cadbury committee, the CII committee, then the Kumar Mangalam Birla report, and also the Narayan Murthy committee report is what we looked at further. Then we looked at what is likely to be the future BOD's role. So, we said in the light of what is happening in the country, BODs may need to become more international. Then may have to consider the interests of all key stakeholders and not just who owns stock while taking strategic decisions. Then the ability to articulate a strategic vision and motivate people to achieve it may become the most important characteristics required of a CEO. Then we looked at the Then we looked at the different environments a company might be facing. It could be the, that was the environmental analysis, that is whether what is meant by the mega environment, what is meant by the micro environment, what is meant by the relevant environment. We took different examples to explain this, and we gave a taxonomy of the firm's environment by different diagrams. We defined what are the important variables in societal environment with respect to economic, technological, political and legal, then socio-cultural. So, we gave a slide which gives list down the variables. The important economic variables could be GDP trends, interest rates, money supply, then inflation rates, the unemployment levels, the wage and the price controls, then the devaluation or the revaluation, then the energy cost, availability, then the disposable and discretionary income. Then in the technological variables, we said the total government spending for R&D, then the total industry spending for R&D, then the focus of the technological efforts, then the patent protection, new products, new developments in technology transfer from lab to the marketplace, then the productivity improvements, that is what is the type of automation that is coming in, then the and with respect to political legal variables, the antitrust like regulations, the environmental protection laws, then the tax laws, special incentives, foreign trade regulations, then attitudes towards foreign companies, then laws on hiring and promotion, then the stability of the government, then we came to the socio-cultural variables. We looked at lifestyle change, then the career expectations, consumer activism, role rate of family formation, then the growth rate of population, the age distribution of population, the regional shifts in population, the life expectancies and the birth rates. So, all this we have looked at. So, we have given a diagram where we listed down the competitive landscape, what is really happening with respect to competition. This diagram, if you see, at the bottom you are having the hyper competitive environments in which the firms are competing now. The what is really happening is the fundamental nature of competition is changing. So, how is it getting reflected? So, you have this emergence of the global economy creating all this hyper competitive environments, then you have the rapid technological change, mostly brought about by the information age and the increasing knowledge intensity, then all this leading to a sea change with respect to the business environment. So, we looked at the different technology missions with respect to the country, that is India's technology missions. whether it was providing drinking water or promoting literacy or stepping up child immunization or hiking up production of oil seeds or linking the remote areas with countries' telecommunication network or the NICnet. And we said, what should be the industry response given this type of hyper competitiveness? So, we listed down the entrepreneurial form of response can be with respect to the changes in the form of product group or processing technology or the raw materials, the technological developments in related areas, then the type of technological development changes in the different stages, that is the invention, innovation and diffusion. And we also looked at what are the types of opportunity and threats, the matrix of opportunities, the impact of opportunities and the threat matrix. Then we listed down how can we go about listing these factors, then the table, and gave what we call an external factors analysis summary with respect to opportunities and threats. We took the example of a company and said what are the types of weights that can be given, what is the type of ratings that the company got, and what is the weighted score. Similarly, when we went through the whole process, again we listed what is going to happen or what might happen to the environment in the 21st century, where we said you have an increasing environmental uncertainty. So, when we said increasing environmental uncertainty, the importance of environmental scanning becomes highly predominant. So, then what is the type of inference one could draw? That is, to remain competitive, companies will have to develop better methods of gathering, evaluating and disseminating intelligence to those who need it. Then we said to manage strategically, organizations have to become more attuned to the many stakeholders who are affected by the company's actions. Shareholders will form only one part of the equation. So, some important points coming out due to the hyper competitive environment in which firms are operating now. Then the distinction between developed and developing nations will begin to fade as developing nations take on a greater proportion of the world trade. Then as more and more industries become hyper competitive, strategy will become increasingly short term in orientation. You are looking at a strategy which is sometimes we took the examples from the Indian context only, where we said many software companies are looking at a 1 year strategic management time horizon. So, the hyper competitive scenario is making this time element of strategy become increasingly short term. So, one of the questions which I wanted you to ponder over was whether strategic management, can it exist with only a short time horizon? It is already shrinking. So, when we looked at corporate planning, it was looking at a 5 to 10 year scenario. When we came to strategic management, we said we are looking at a 3 year scenario. Now you are looking at companies which are looking at a strategic management time horizon of 1 year only. So then we came to the internal corporate analysis. So when we came to the internal corporate analysis, that is the strengths and the weaknesses. So with respect to the strengths and the weaknesses, we said what could be the criteria for determination of the strengths and weaknesses could be historic, that is past performance, can be sales, profit after tax, capacity utilization, or it can, the normative is where you judge what ought to be on level of performance, that is the expert opinion. Then the competitive parity, that is firm must at minimum meet the actions of competitors, that is should identify dimensions of uniqueness. Then we looked at the fourth criteria, that is the critical factors of success, that is the CFS or the KFS, and we also said one criterion seldom sufficient to evaluate a firm. We looked at the measures, it can be attribute, effectiveness or efficiency. Then we looked at what is meant by an impact matrix. Then we looked at the types of industry structures possible, that is it can be perfect competition or monopolistic competition or oligopoly or monopoly. So then we looked at competitor analysis, why should we do it? So we looked at the routes to competitive advantage, so can be function differentiation or exploiting the competitor's weaknesses or taking aggressive initiatives or maximizing the user benefit through the strategic degree of freedom. Then we looked at the three generic strategies of Porter, whether it is with respect to differentiation or overall cost leadership and the focus. So all that was what we looked at. We took number of examples for competition from the marketing warfare point of view. So, from the Indian context, explained the whole scenario. Then we looked at again a Porter's sub model, which gave us what are the essential aspects of supply chain management. So, if you looked at this, we said these are the firm, they form the firm's value chain. So if you see, we looked at the primary activities, the support activities, what forms the support activities, what forms the primary activities, and what is meant by the margin, and how will the value chain affect the performance of the firm? So, the primary activities mainly are the inbound logistics, the operations, outbound logistics, then the marketing and sales, then the services, then the support activities are the firm infrastructure, the human resource management, the technology development and the procurement. We also listed down after this basically what are the vendors' cost leadership, when is it not sustained? Similarly, when is differentiation not sustained? when is focus not stress sustained as a strategy route? We gave the 8 dimensions of quality as performance, that is the primary operating characteristics such as a washing machine's cleaning ability, features, that is an example is the cruise control in a car. Features supplements the basic functions, then the reliability, probability that the product will continue functioning without any significant maintenance. Conformance, degree to which a product meets standards. When a customer buys a product out of the warehouse, it will perform identically to that viewed on the showroom floor. Then what is meant by durability? Number of years of service a consumer can expect from a product before it significantly deteriorates. Differs from reliability in that a product can be durable, but still need a lot of maintenance. Kindly note these points. A product can be durable, but with a lot of maintenance, then you cannot say it is a reliable product. Then serviceability is product's ease of repair. Aesthetics is how a product looks, feels, sounds, tastes or smells. Then perceived quality is the product's overall reputation, especially important if there are no objective easily used measures of quality. So, we gave all this and we listed down the key factors for success with respect to an organization, that is what was given by Kenichi Ohme. So, it can be raw material procurement, raw material processing or product fabrication, assembly, design, distribution, marketing or service. So, what could be the KFS to increase profits, to gain market share was given with reference to different industries. When we gave the alternative formats for analysis with respect to strengths and weaknesses, we gave the approach that is listed by Bates and Eldridge. Then the strengths and weaknesses profile, how we can make use of the 7S matrix. Then we listed the Porter's model of industry competition, that is popularly known as the 5 forces model. We explained this model in great detail. So, what is the type of competition the companies might face with respect to the degree of rivalry, then the potential entrants, the substitutes, then the suppliers and the buyers, all the 5 forming these 5 forces. Then we listed down some of the important organizational analysis frameworks. One is the Vrio framework, where in the Vrio the VRIO stands for value. Does it provide competitive advantage, rarity? Do other competitors possess it? I for imitability, is it costly for others to imitate? O for organization, is the firm organized to exploit the resources? We gave number of examples to buttress all these points. Then we said we came to important aspects of how to use resources to gain competitive advantage. So, we said depending on the strengths and the weaknesses of the firm, how can one go to specific capabilities, that is the corporate capabilities, often called the core competencies. From the core competencies, firm should move towards the distinctive competencies. And what is meant by this sustainable competitive advantage, and how do you determine the sustainability of an advantage? The three aspects: one is durability, immutability. Immutability again determined by transparency, transferability, then replicability. We gave examples for all this. We used all this to draw the internal factors analysis summary, that is the IFAS matrix. So, we took the example of the company Maytag and listed down the weights, ratings, the weighted score, what could be the, what is the type of comments that emerged out of this matrix. So, then we listed down the global issues for the 21st century in the light of this hyper competitive scenario, when more and more companies are becoming hyper competitive, it will become harder to maintain competitive advantage. Unless a company has a distinctive competency, which is not only hard to imitate, but also durable. Durability has, however, little value during technological discontinuity. Kindly note all these statements. So, as more and more companies become hyper competitive, it will become harder for a company to maintain competitive advantage, unless it has a distinctive competency, which is not only hard to imitate, but also durable. Durability has, however, little value during technological discontinuity. Then what is likely to happen in the 21st century? Subcontracting by firms to reduce costs and become globally competitive, that is what is what we are referring to as outsourcing. Then primary activities to increase in importance in hyper competitive global industries, that is the Porter's value chain. With respect to the Porter's value chain, the primary activities, that is the inbound logistics, outbound logistics, all the types of the activities which we listed down. Then we said it is very possible that we will have autonomous work teams, has already come in with respect to IT industries, and these work teams should have better training to handle competitive environments. Then we said we came to the SFAS matrix, how to develop this SFAS matrix from the EFAS matrix and the IFAS matrix, which we have already looked at or which we have already drawn with respect to a company. So, we took the example of the Maytag company, and then we said using this EFAS and the IFAS matrix, we draw the SFAS matrix. So, we listed down the important strengths, weaknesses, what could be the weight that could be attached, then similarly the opportunities and the threats. Overall, we listed about 10 of them, that is taking the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats with respect to a company. So, this is a typical way of going about strategic factor analysis with respect to an organization. So, we listed all this, we looked at then before we went further, we looked at how to analyze a case. So, we will take up this aspect of what we went through in quick in a quick round summary in the next class. We will stop here. Thank you.